Hey guys, thank you for joining us again for another exciting episode of YOMO. This is the Year of Magical Learning podcast. And today, Reflection 359 is, it says something about
Stanley Tucci, man.
Stanley Tucci. I mean, it sounds Italian to me. I don't know.
Don't know who Stanley Tucci is?
I don't.
What the hell?
I do not. I do not.
Have you
I've
ever
been
seen?
living on the rock.
Dude, you know who Stanley Tucci is. Hang on, let me. Oh, gosh, I know I need to pull it up. He's in Devil Wears Prada. Do you remember? Have you ever seen Devil Wears Prada?
Yeah, vaguely.
He was like Meryl Streep's like head designer guy that like was the gay dude that was her like that she kept screwing over all the time. He's God, dude, this guy's been in a ton of famous movies. He's a really famous actor. Here, I'll show you a photo of him.
Oh, okay, that guy. I've seen him.
Yeah, here. He's in he's an Italian American, by the way. So I mean that like that's but yeah, this.
I seen him in the commercial, something about some alcoholic drink or something like that.
He does make really good. So during COVID, he became like super famous because he made like really interesting like cocktails for people on like Facebook Live and stuff, and they all love. He's like this. He's like class personified kind of dude. He's just like really really really. What's the word when somebody's like very cultured? He's very cultured. Like he's very just cultured. I don't know how else to describe Stanley Tucci other than like. But here's some of the movies he's been in: Devil Wears Prada, Julia and Julia, Road to Perdition,
Yeah, a lot of movies.
tons. Yeah, Captain America. Hunger Games,
Hunger
Spotlight.
Games, yeah.
I mean, he's been in a ton of stuff. During the pandemic, there was a series that CNN had created that started right before the pandemic happened, and it was like, kind of took off, honestly, because everybody was stuck at home watching Netflix and whatever. It was called, I think it was called Tasting Italy. Maybe Tasting Italy. Searching for Italy. So Stanley Tucci and had this Netflix. It was on CNN originally, but then Netflix picked it up and it became like super popular. It was him just, going to his Italian roots and going around and. Eating food all over Italy, basically, and like exploring different, cultural spots in Italy, and it was just really, really good TV. Not only that, Stanley Tucci is just a really interesting guy. So, my wife, the reason why this is called 22 Books is the reflection title. This is our 22nd book that my wife and I did together over the Yomel journey, and I wanted to call it out on this particular reflection because. This is probably the last one that I was going to write. This is the last one that we did, in the 365, the run, the original, 365 Year of Magical Learning. So this officially marked our last book that we finished together, and Stanley Tucci has like a special place in both of our hearts. A, for that Searching for Italy show, because we both really enjoyed it, but B, I'm Italian American, and Stanley Tucci is also Italian American, and his family life is very much so. Just I don't know, hearing about his childhood and how he grew up and his family, it was reminding me a lot of like my family and how we grew up and the things that we did. And then for Felicia, my wife, she loves food and she's a big foodie kind of person, like one of those, typical millennials that like to go out for brunch and and blah 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 and whatever. That's totally my wife. She's very I believe the word is basic, when it comes to stuff like that, right? So when we finished our previous book before this, I saw this one. I had it kind of queued up that Audible does a really good job of algorithms, right? And I saw this that he had just released Stanley Tucci had just released a memoir, and it was called Taste, right? So it's about Stanley Tucci's life through food, and told my wife this, and I was like, hey, do you want to make this our next book? And she was like, oh yeah, like I mean, I love Stanley Tucci and love food and can't wait to hear his take on all these things. And it was a really good book. Actually, I learned a lot about the guy's life. He He's actually gone through a lot. His wife died, his first wife died, early on. Not early on. I mean, they had a full life together, but then she passed away when they were, I think when he was in like in his 40s or 50s or something like that. And then he got cancer of the throat as well. So he couldn't even eat anything or swallow anything for many, many, months. I had no idea that he was going through a lot of the stuff. So this book is about his just love of food since he was a child, and his life through food, as it is today, as it's, all the ups and downs of his life in between. And this is a really interesting book. I mean, learned about some new dishes I never knew about, and learned about his life, and it was cool. But as this relates to this the journey, the 22 books was kind of like something I had to stop and take a reflection about, because it's like, holy shit, like my wife and I read or consumed, most of them, well, they were all Audible books because we were listening to them together, consumed 22 different books together over the time of this journey from start to finish, which is almost mind blowing to me because like never in a million years would I have ever assumed I would consume a book with my wife. Let alone, before our daughter came along, but let alone 22, like, I mean, we are officially that weird ass family that, it all started with Matthew McConaughey's Greenlights book. So it was
Is that
about
the
a,
first book?
that was the first book, right? So it was about a year into Yomel, and Amelia and I had, were having a blast, like, just devouring all kinds of, stuff and learning new stuff every single day, and having a lot of fun. And there was this one Saturday after Luca was born, and he was still in the NICU, and we were at home and cooking breakfast before we went there. And I was like, hey, you wanna listen to a book together? Because I just felt like we were leaving her out of it. I wanted her to, to engage in it. And she goes, ah, sure, I guess I'd be open to that. So I was like, well, I just bought this Matthew McConaughey book. I don't know if you're interested in trying it. She was like, sure, why not? So we ended up turning it on that like Saturday morning while we were ate breakfast and had a quick meal before we went back to the NICU with Luca. And for like an hour, it was just really fun. I mean, we just had a good time just sitting there listening, laughing. And Matthew McConaughey's book was awesome, Greenlights book, and we really enjoyed it. So the next weekend we did it again, right? We the weekend came and we turned on the book, and we were just eating breakfast and having a good time. And slowly but surely over the course of the next couple of weeks, we finished the book, and we're like, do you want to try it again? She was like, yeah, sure, whatever. So we did another one, and then we did another one, then we did another one, then slowly and surely it morphed into our Amelia walks every night, or then pushing Luca around in a stroller every time that we would take a walk, we would take a little portable Bluetooth speaker with us, and we'd just play a book as we walked around the park. We were just churning through books all over the place, here you go. Fast forward, 22 books later, and we're at, book number 359 in the journey, and writing about it and finishing Stanley Tucci's book. And I just thought it was something like a really special thing that I wanted to share in this journey of how magical some of these things are when you start to the compound effect and it all comes into play, and you get other people you care about doing stuff that you care about as well. And it just makes it like a way more magical experience. And as it relates to the book in particular, what I learned most was with Stanley Tucci, I don't know, there's something about the guy that just really draws you in. And I don't know exactly what it is, but we absolutely loved it. And the thing I learned the most from it was he talked a lot about his family, right? And my Italian American roots were very much so all up on our shit, with our families all over each. I mean, I'm sure a lot of, immigrant-ish e families are similar, but like, Italians have a famous, we talk a lot with our hands, and we are all in our Star Wars business, and we're all loud and obnoxious and annoying, and like that's very much so my family. But it makes me really happy to be around my family and my people, and being around people that I love and people that I care about, and spending time with them. And this book reminded me of, how grateful I am of this journey and how it's helped connect my family better together. And anytime that I can spend time with my kids and my wife and my family, or anybody else that I care about, like it's time well spent, and I absolutely love it. And like, I mean, I think that's what life's about, right? Anyway, that was a reflection. It's kind of an easy one for the day, but love to hear your thoughts.
I mean, I guess I guess the lessons of the day is you are who you are. Right? I mean, I can't make any simpler because we keep saying a beaver must dam, right? If you're a beaver, right, you want to be in an environment that's suitable for the beaver. You are a tiger, right? You're going to be in an environment that's suitable for a tiger because that's who you are. You connect, you can relate. And the thing that you do, like you said, the once you have found a path that resonates with who you are as that person, you're doing these things, and you don't even notice because you so immerse yourself inside of the activity itself. You're enjoying the moment. You don't realize how much accumulation, how much compound effect has occurred for you to look back and say, well, we did 22 books together,
22 books. Yeah, I mean.
right? And we look back from your perspective and my perspective, we did 359 books together,
I mean, that's
right?
wild. I mean,
I mean,
it's wild.
you think about that, right? But you and I don't usually
Don't really think about it.
take
I mean, it.
we don't look at it. We only look at, okay, I get to talk shit about stuff that I care about every single day.
But
And that's all, and that's who we are.
it's just fun. I mean, and
Other
you want
people
to do
might
it.
like other something else, but for us, this is what resonates with us as this group. And so you are who you are. Be who you gotta be and do what you gotta do. I mean, it's as simple as that. I mean, it's not easy, but it's simple. It's very simple.
I agree. I mean, the compound effect, like you said, is it's not even something that you, I think what the coolest, one of the coolest things about the compound effect is you don't even really feel it, like it's only in moments when you do take a step, like just like you're climbing up a mountain and you happen to like look down or something and you're like, fuck, I'm pretty high up here. But like you didn't even realize you were just in the zone climbing, and all of a sudden you like look down and you're like, wow, all right, we've gone pretty far. But like, I mean, we're not stopping. Like, we're having a good time and we're enjoying it. But like, it's just the truly magical, I guess is the only word that I can describe it, of progress that gets made doing stuff that you love to do. It just naturally happens. And I don't know other word to say other than
This
magic.
is
It's
a
like it's
power. This is
magic,
the power of time. I mean, the power of
Right.
time. People can't really fathom the power of time. But the thing is, that's in a way for you to compare what you did versus someone else somebody did. But at the same time, to me, it doesn't really matter, because the thing is,
Oh yeah, I
a
agree.
compound effect is usually presented to the people as a comparison to say, hey, you got to walk that much to become better, maybe to beat me. But in the game of life, you're not competing with another person. You're competing with yourself, because the thing is, how far you get is up to you. How far you get is how much you want it. So it's not about, okay, I let's say you and I, we drive a car, right? We drive and we travel. In the life, in that kind of scenario, well, if you travel from the West Coast to the East Coast, right? And I travel from Texas to Florida, I mean, to me, it's what I want to do. It has nothing to do with distances. It's how I feel, how the emotions of my present in life, taking the gift of life and doing something with it that aligns with who I want to be, or I need to be. And that is all that matters. It's not about, oh, True drove less than Chris, or Chris drove more than True. So you think about a comparison and say, hey, I did this much. If you and I were to do 365 books, but we don't enjoy it, it doesn't mean shit.
Yeah, actually, it's even worse. I mean, it's worse. It's like,
But
what are you fucking doing?
that's
Like,
what people used to do as a comparison. So I think
yes.
the I guess the concept that people have conjured up over the years, most of this concept really doesn't benefit anyone. We talked about the golden rule yesterday, right? It doesn't benefit anyone because you think about how the golden rule is defined. It isn't a good thing because it doesn't work. And same thing with the compound effect. Yes, the compound effect is this and that and that, but Yes, I can do a lot of work. Let's say I'm really good at coding, but I've hated coding. It doesn't matter how good I am. Let's say I'm really good at making money, right? I can make $1 billion, but if I don't need the money for whatever is gonna bring me joy, then it doesn't matter how much money I make. You think
Like
about it, like let's
it's
say
like
this
making
is
a third pumpkin pie, you know, when you only wanted a slice or whatever, and you're like, what do I do with it? Like, I don't want to keep making pumpkin pies. I just wanted one slice of pie, you know, like that's it. Like, I'm good. I can make one slice of pie and I'm good. You know, I'm happy.
So that I think that's the thing is you have to get the point. Don't miss the point. What is the point, right? And every single person's point is going to be different. It is their own particular perspectives and point of view and what they want in life and what they enjoy in life. And what you enjoy in life, it depends on who you are made, how you are made. It's not how who you want to be. So I don't. Let's say I want to be Elon Musk, but I don't have the capability. I want to be Tom Brady, or I want to be Michael Jordan, or I want to be LeBron James. You know I can't, right? And
Well, you
so
could. I mean, if you were, if that was your beaver, you know, beavering activity. I mean, you
no,
could.
it's not. But it's not because
Well, no, you
if
can't
I
literally be them. I mean,
no, because
you'd be the true
no,
version of them.
it's still not because if I had the faculty. Then I would be beavering, but because I don't have the
Right.
faculty,
So
then it
I'm
doesn't.
saying.
I mean, you think about it, beaver, right? Why does a beaver like water? Because it has a waterproof pelt. I mean, it's just like, well, why do LeBron James like basketball? He has the capability to play basketball with all the physical traits and the mental and the emotion that goes with it. And I may have the emotion, but I lack the physical trait. It's not a beaver must damn activity.
Oh, I know what you're saying. I was just saying, I guess you could be that. That could be you, but I mean that it's not you. It's not actually you, but it could be you. I mean, there's no reason why it can't
Right,
be.
because the thing it has to align with all the pieces. It
Right.
can't
If
just
all those
align
pieces
with
were
one
present.
piece. Like let's say, to me, I love football, but I'm this 5'6" guy, right? And when I was in high school, I was like 4 something. I wasn't even 5 feet. I was four
Really?
something. Yeah,
Like
short,
graduated?
not graduated, but
Oh, okay.
like freshman in high school, I was 4 feet
Gotcha.
something.
Wow.
You
Well.
know, but I'm saying is, I like football. I just don't have the stature to play football.
Right.
So I
My mom would
can't
love you
say,
playing.
hey, I want to be a quarterback or blah blah whatever. This is
Right.
why this is why this is the this is the I guess the advice I give my nephews. Live in the world of probability, not possibility. Possibility means, hey, can you become a Tom Brady? There's a possibility, but it's
Sure.
not probability,
Right.
right? So don't live in that world. You're being brainwashed by all these underdog stories. That is the best advice that he ever received, and he come back from college and he told me that's the main thing is let you gotta do what you have the faculty to do. Don't do things because you wish something.
Or like, and the stuff that you have the faculty to do is probably stuff that you're going to enjoy anyway. Like, I mean,
Exactly. That's why
it's
it's why it
like
has
nobody
to
wants to do
align.
stuff they don't want to do. Like, I mean, like I was just talking to my friend David today, who's going to be actually working at Indianapolis Pickleball Club with me, which I'm excited about that. He we were playing tennis today because he's a tennis buddy of mine, and I, you know, was we were talking about exactly about this exact topic of the difference between tennis. Of working on your backhand and not and life in real life of like why would you work on your backhand in real life, you know, like what's the point? You know, it's not it, life isn't a game where there's defined rules or not, and we've talked about this so many different times that I'm not gonna like rehash it, but it was one of those like just such a stark, you know, realizations where we're literally talking about tennis as we're playing tennis, and I'm like, yes, you need to work on your back if you want to improve in this game. You have to address your weaknesses, right? Because it's a game, like, and somebody will exploit it at some level along the way, you know, because that's the point of the game. The point it's to win the game. Like, I don't know that there's any point to winning. I don't know, there is no way to win life, you know, like the only way
In
to
life, in the game of life, the rules are very dynamic and they're different. And
It's an infinite game.
the only rules is when you lose. It's not when you win. It's when you lose.
That's a great
Like
point. Yeah,
it's how fast you lose. And when you lose, it's meaning when you quit.
It's a via negativa of life. Right?
It is,
Yeah, I mean
right?
you're right. Yeah, I mean you're either going in the direction you want to go or you're via negativa, I guess, in life, you know, but like it's pretty stark obvious where you should focus your attention. Like after at least for us after this journey, it's like why would you
Your
ever
focus
focus
of
your
attention
attention
is not to quit.
on the stuff that you like? I mean, that's it. I mean, only the
No,
stuff
but
that you
no.
enjoy.
The thing is, I guarantee you, if you're doing something you don't like, how likely is it for you to quit? You think about
Like
it. Think
we're
about it in life,
told,
right?
I
In
mean,
life, let's say I told you to go work in a salt mine, right? How long you think you work there? Let's say in life you have this chronic disease. How long do you want to live? But in
great
life,
point.
if you have like a healthy body, healthy mind, right? And life is just joyful for you. How long do you want to live? I'm talking about life. It's when it's not about life. You don't can't win in life. Okay, it's
Right.
about when you lose. When you lose, it's like okay, when you quit. When you quit, it means when you die. Meaning, like in life, that's a game of life. You quit when you die. You don't win because you eventually will die. But do you want to hang on to something and endure the, eating the frogs and the heartaches and all these things? And if you do that, let's say you endure those, how far can you go? If you have, let's say me and my exact duplicate were to do like things that I like and the things that they force my twin to do, how long do you think he's gonna say, my life sucks? The hell with it. I'm gonna light my last cigarettes. You think
Yeah, right.
about that concept a little bit. So it's not about, but so yes, in a way, indirectly, it's a thing you like to do. But when you want to survive the long game as long as you want, the only viable solutions for you to survive the longest is to do the things that makes you feel joy. That
Gives you
is the
energy. I mean, it's about
only
energy.
answer.
It's energy
So
management.
that particular requirement will automatically veer you toward the answers of you got to do things you like. Because otherwise, it doesn't matter what it is. Because
You honestly don't have a choice. I mean,
if you being let imagine you go and you do something that you don't like. Okay, there's the compound effect will kick in. We're talking about like, hey, I'm too stressed out. I can't eat right. My body is ached. You do all these things. It just compound you and it just grab you and pull you to the ground, right? You're going to let go of life because so many things are just yanking on you. It's just miserable,
It is. It's heavy. It's
right?
heavy. It's
It is very heavy. So it doesn't
is, yeah.
matter that one single threat of starting something you don't like. When you start something you don't like, you say, I hated doing this. I hate talking to people. I hate running around. I hate blah, blah, blah. That hate in turn creates your stress. That stress in turn creates your the chemicals in your body to release. And that chemical doesn't get you to give you the ability to sleep, right? It doesn't give your body the ability to heal, right? And you get older and you get weaker, and then that becomes like a liability. I become weaker, I get sick more prone, I do less work, I sleep less, I get, you name it. Everything starts to unravel from that starting point.
Right. I agree. Yeah.
And then if that becomes, I guarantee you, people say, in life you gotta live a little, right? You only live once. That's bullshit. You live every day, you die once. You quit. Once you quit, you're done. But that's what
Good
I'm
point.
saying is you can't say, well, you only live once. I'm gonna do whatever I need to do. I'm gonna smoke shit. I'm gonna drink till I pass out, or I'm going to inject poison. Or I'm gonna do this stupid dare somebody dares me to do because I have this macho of an attitude, whatever, right? You do that shit, and then when you get to the point where you are on this defibrillator or on this oxygen tank, right? And pain is constantly like nagging at you. You wish you have a gun that they can shoot you in the head. People don't understand that until you got it. So you don't tell me that, hey, live a little. Until you have the chronic pain, then you come back and you give me your answer. But otherwise, if you have been there, you don't know shit.
Yeah, I mean, I tend to agree with everything you said, and I don't think there's anything I can argue with. As a matter of fact, like I think that's one of the central themes of this whole journey is like, like time's short, and like don't fucking waste it, like doing shit that you don't want to do and around people you don't want to be around, and it's kind of as simple as that. I mean,
I
I
mean,
know it sounds like.
I'm going to ask you this question again. I've asked you this before, but you imagine Steve Jobs, right? He has, I don't know, a couple of billion dollars, $100 billion, whatever it is. He's got a lot of money, okay? He has pancreatic cancer. If I were to come to him and say, I will give you 10 more years, or I'll give you one more years, but I want $1 billion, will you pay for it? Do you think he will give me $1 billion to give him one more year?
Yeah, I'm
Knowing
sure
that
he
he's
would
going to
go in.
die that day.
I'm sure he would go into debt, if that's what you
Exactly.
asked him to do. I
So
mean,
you're
'cause you,
talking about
that's what
time.
we spend money on,
Time
man. We spend money
is
on what you care
more
about.
precious than anything in the world to you. Okay? So.
Everything, all of your resources need to go toward doing what you want to do, whether it's your money, whether it's
So
your
don't
time,
waste
whether it's your,
time. I mean,
right,
the thing is,
exactly.
don't spend the time on something that is not matters to you. So you think about what I just said. Steve Jobs, let's say Steve Jobs knows he dies today, right? He say, well, the doctor said you die today. I come into you and say, hey, I can give you one more year, but I want $1 billion in exchange. Or heck, I say, hey, I want 50 billion. Or heck, I want every single dime that you have. Do you think he will pay it? Or if I ask him, I want triple what you have,
I'm
he
sure
can
he'd
say,
figure
well,
it out.
I'm going to debt to get
Right.
it, right? That's the thing is, this is how value time is to a person. But here, we're wasting it. We're doing some shit we don't want to do because, we have time. Because
I
we
mean,
don't
I had to
fathom the time concept for us.
agreed. I had the option in 2024 at this point in time to make $250,000 or to spend $250,000. That's a $500,000 swing, right? Like, and I gladly said I'd rather go spend $250,000 because I get to do what I want to do every single day, and it's while it's stressful and while I'm, like whatever, like I'm enjoying all this. I'm enjoying all of it. Like I'm enjoying building out this facility. I'm enjoying hiring people. I'm enjoying people getting excited about a game that I like, and care about, and that are excited with me about something. I'm enjoying talking to companies about it. I'm enjoying, I don't enjoy spending money, but like, I mean, I enjoy spending money on
Well,
stuff that I like,
I think it's a concept we've been conditioned to avoid, but I
It
don't think
is.
it matters because you think about the people who live in the on the land, right? And they live off the land and they have no need for money. It's like spending money doesn't mean anything to them, right? It's just that we have been conditioned to hold on to that money for whatever reason. We have
Loss
this, I
aversion.
guess, this loss aversion in us somehow, right? That's why you don't enjoy spending money. But
I hate it. Some people do.
if you get to the point where you understand it and you can condition yourself out of that conditions, then spending money is no problem. Because say like let's say imagine this. The money, it isn't yours and it will never be yours. There's just this
It
money
isn't.
in the bank, and then you can just write the check, right?
I mean,
You can
it
write the check
literally,
all day. You can write the check all day until it's gone.
I mean,
But
it really, it's
in this
literally
case,
it,
it isn't.
in this case, it literally isn't, and I am, and I don't care either way, to be honest with you, because it's, I've kind of, like, I think to your point, what you just said, I'm kind of desensitized to it now at this point in time, like I'm like, what is this? I mean, who even cares? Like the thing that's kind of mind blowing to me, and because it's been so mind blowing to other people, is like I'm not like rich, by any means. Like I would never call myself rich, but it like I wouldn't even call myself half rich or even quarter rich. I mean, I would just say I'm just a normal person that has a normal amount of money, in my opinion. Like, I mean, I don't know that it's like I don't know. I don't know. I don't think that it's a lot, but like it, you know, it's okay, right? You know, but whenever I tell anybody that's also in the similar kind of boat as me, they're like, "Well, is it just you that's doing this?" Like, you know, and I'm like, "Yeah." And they're like,
Holy shit.
how is that? And I'm like, I don't
You're
know. I'm
pretty
just
rich.
figuring it out. I don't know, you know, but like, and I know that what I would be thinking, you know, before, you know, I even started to go through this journey, I would be going like, man, is like Chris just sitting on like a couple $1 million or whatever that he just doesn't give a shit about? Like, and you know, and like, you know, no, the answer is no. I mean, like, that's not the case at all. And I don't need somebody else. Like, I mean, it almost has been so oddly easy to acquire money to do what I'm trying to do right now, that it almost makes me wonder why people need to go hustle so hard to raise funds for stuff that they're
It's
doing.
because you're
Like,
conditioned for that. You are
we are like
you
to
are
like beg, you
conditioned
know?
in a concept, that money is hard. And you 99%, and maybe 98% of all the things that prevent you from doing anything or getting into money, it's you. You are sabotaging yourself because you don't have the confidence and you have the scarcity mentality, right? The world is abundant, right? It's abundant because you know you can live off the land, and it's unlimited potential to live off the land. And God give you all the resources, all the land for you to do. Just like, hey, if you say, hey, I need to harvest some water for people to drink, right? For me to go and get a bucket and go to the river and scoop it up, right? One of them is not gonna work. But if somebody goes, hey, how about I build you a wheel out of the tree, right? And I can just wheel create a water wheel and bring the water automatic to you, right? That is called I mean, it's not like when something is gained, something's missing, right? A person as a creator in us, we are the creators, right? We're not as opposed to the composer. We are the creators. We create things, and so the creating is it create one thing and create 10,000 of value, 10,000 X's value, right? So as long as we have the human ingenuity, we can multiply 1,000 times, 100,000 times, 1,000,000 times the things that you need. So if you think about the abundancy of the world itself, you will get out your own fucking elephant's way and let the elephant do its job. And then when you do that, it's easy because it's all, I mean, you go out there, right? Dirt is there, air is there, tree is there, everything's there for you. When I mean, hey, you know, you think you, people say, hey, this money goes on trees? Yes, it does.
Yeah, I
Because I
mean,
can fucking go cut the wood,
it's
right?
literally
It's literally money. So if you keep saying, you know, money don't grow on trees, well, that's your mentality. You just stop yourself from being creative to say, hey, there's trees there, well, there's fruits
there's money
there's
somewhere, man.
sap there, man, there's shade there, there's leaves there, and there's soil there. There's like so many things you can do with it because you have a scarcity mentality versus a abundance mentality. Abundant mentality is, you know, you say, well, it's not like I take one tree and that tree is going to be given to somebody else and that tree is missing. It's not that kind in the world of dynamic. The wicked world that we live in is so dynamic that you have the option to do that. And if this is reality though. Reality is that it is abundant. Because you think if there's so many things out there, it's like you cut one tree and you plant something, it grows five times.
I'm chuckling because the same David guy that I was talking to you about earlier, I was telling him my plan of making money for this facility, and I was like, I'm gonna go after like the corporate dollars, like, you know, because I was explaining to him my life at like Salesforce and how just grotesque amount of money that we just spend on the dumbest shit, you know, like taking clients out or travel or whatever else, you know, all the like, and it's just, you know, $10,000 for my monthly expenses just to travel, you know, and entertain customers or something like that. And it's just like, what the fuck? Like, that doesn't make any sense, you know. But like, and he's like, he asked me, he was like, where do how do they make some, how do they afford that? And I'm like, you know, I don't really honestly know. I mean, really at the end of the day. And I go, well, and then I told him my strategy about doing it for like the corporate health and wellness, you know, kind of dollars, I guess, if you will, for the facility. And I was like, I'm gonna go after that stuff because I know they got a shitload of money. They can just go, as long as I can talk to the right people and figure out how to convince the right people to do this, like write me a check, we'll be able to be okay. And everybody else will focus on the member experience, you know, and just the one-off people that are really going to be the heart of the club. But he started laughing. He goes, it reminds me of this South Park episode. And I've never actually seen this clip, but he said it. And I, you, what you just triggered my own thoughts. So I wanted to hear this really fast. You ready? All right.
What exactly does Canada want? We want more money. Yeah, more money. More money from where? How about the internet? The internet makes lots of money, so give us some of that money. Yeah, give us internet money.
Mr. Bootman, you seem to not understand how global economics works. I think
just give me that fat cat, fancy lip wiggling. Are you going to give Canada more money or not?
There you go.
You should go there. Chris needs money. Chris wants money. Are you gonna give Chris money or not?
that was another famous oh, well, now you just made me think of another really famous we used to do this all the time. Here it is.
Coding is like, you know, with coding, when you're in that like flow state, you're hyper focused, you're not really aware of it.
Do we? Hey.
Hey there. So, it's been 24 hours. Got my money?
Oh, you know what? Just give me till next Friday. I'll have it for you.
Oh, that's funny. I could have sworn I said have it today.
Yeah, I don't have it. Sorry.
Oh, well, all right then. That's good, OJ. You got till 5 o'clock. You hear me? You got till 5 o'clock.
You friggin' psychopath.
And clean yourself up.
Man,
what's it have to do with what we're talking about?
this just reminded me of where's my money, man? You know, we used to. There used to be memes all the time, you know.
It's not your money. Yeah, it's not your money.
Where's my money? No, I don't know. I don't know. We're off track. We're off topic. All right. Enough. I think final thoughts for Stanley Tucci today.
Follow your money. What money means to you.
Just do things that you love with people that you love to do it with, and I think your life will be pretty good, you know. I mean, that's my advice, you know. So find more of the stuff to connect with more of the people that you love, man. Like, you know, and life will be all right.
It's as simple as that.
I mean, I don't know how much more simple you can make life sometimes, but
you just make it difficult.
Yeah, we do. You know, we just yeah, we do. I mean, we really just make it a lot harder than it is, you know.
I mean, this is why people overthink things for the useless stuff.
Right.
Like, you know, what do I want? I'm gonna want a car. No, I'm gonna want a job, so I can make money. I'm gonna make a lot of money. Then we're gonna buy a car. They're gonna have a nice car. I'm gonna have a nice clothes. So I'm gonna drive around the neighborhood, and I'm gonna, you know, spend a lot of money. You're gonna drink a lot. So what's the point? Oh, I just want a girlfriend. Why don't you go to the girl you like, you know, learn about what she likes, right? And give her what she likes, right?
Sounds
in the platinum rule, Sounds smart to me. Done.
Sounds smart to me. I mean,
when you think about it, you go all round about. So what are you doing? And the girl, and you don't even have any commonality with the girl, and you never give the girl what she wants. She doesn't want your fucking car, right?
Right.
She just want her, Louis Vuitton or whatever. Just go buy her a Louis Vuitton bag.
Right.
Right.
Yep.
So why do you bring? Why do you drive a Ferrari in front of a girl? Right? Oh, I have money. I have the ability to buy you a fucking Louis Vuitton. Fine, just go buy a fucking Louis Vuitton and give to her and say, hey, I like you. Here's Louis Vuitton, right?
Agreed.
And you don't, what does she don't, want? And so you go around.
Do what you want. Be direct about it.
This is what people do. They go say, I'm going to work hard. I'm going to climb the corporate ladder. I'm going to retire. I'm going to have a pension. I'm going to do whatever
I
want.
Do shit that I don't want to do for a really long time until I can do what I want to do, which exactly. Is like, why? Yep, I agree. Now, this all comes with a big caveat. Nobody's saying that you're going to know exactly what you want to do right out the gate, right? So try a lot of stuff, but then be
so
super
if you don't
in
know,
tune.
What's the first thing you got to do?
You just try stuff, and then no. You spend time getting to know yourself, like in reflection and thought and whatever, all that other stuff, right? But then you just try shit, but then be super in tune with what you're trying. If you don't like it, then stop. Like, it's okay. Like, if you start a new job and you don't like it, stop. Like, it just, there's no reason to go, well, maybe it'll get better in 2 years.
I don't think it's about the trying. I think the first thing you gotta do is you gotta ask the beautiful question.
But the beautiful question, I think, comes over time. Like, I think the beautiful question comes from trying and living life and of taking a step.
I mean, it's as easy as what do I want?
Yeah.
That's the question you should be asking yourself, what do I want? Until you know what that is. Keep asking the question because when you ask questions, you're going to naturally, okay, if I don't know what I want and I'm asking myself what I want, well, naturally you're going to be looking for answers to that. Right. And then you're going to do, like you say, do whatever you need to do,
try this,
until you can answer the questions. Because then each person's journey is going to be different. You can't say, Chris, and you go try this, you go try that. Just like the guy who played the piano and say, hey, this is how I do my notes by playing the piano, blah, blah, blah. That's you, not him.
Right.
But just give him the framework. The framework is say, ask the question.
Do what you like. Yeah, right. Yes.
What do I want? Yeah. Ask yourself, what do I want? And find answers to that. That's a framework. I'm not telling you how to do it. Oh, go try this and go dig a hole here and then go plant this and go, I don't know. That's your thing. That's
you
specific to you.
Cannot tell somebody else how to figure out that. It's on you to figure it out and keep trying and figure it out. I mean, like, that's the fun of life. Figure it out,
And only you can answer the question though. That's the caveat. It's only you can answer the question. So you have to ask yourself the question. It's what do I want? And a lot of time, like for me, is what do I want? What do you want? Right? We don't know that answer to that question from the beginning.
I kind of knew
what I want.
right. Yeah.
There is a narrowing process of what I want, because you can tell me, hey, true, do you want to partner with me on this? I say no, because that's not what I want. Right. You know what I mean?
You do just know. Actually, I'll tell you when we're done. But I agree. All right, let's put a pen for tonight. 359 in the books. We hit 360 next time that we visit. And can't wait to keep going. We're almost there. All right, everybody. Thanks for joining, and we will see you tomorrow.
See ya. Sounds good. See ya.